In this video, we're going to talk about electronegativity and the different types of covalent bonds. We learned that atoms will form covalent bonds in order to become more stable, and they do this by sharing a pair of electrons. Now we can think of this sharing of a pair of electrons like a tug of war. And so, in this tug of war, sometimes different atoms have different strengths or pulls on those shared electrons. We call that the electronegativity. This is the strength of an atom's pull on a shared electron. Atoms with higher electronegativity pull harder on shared electrons than atoms with a lower electronegativity. The result is that in certain covalent bonds, there is an uneven sharing of the electrons. This can result in partial electrical charges, meaning not quite a full positive charge and not quite a full negative charge, but partial positive and partial negative charges on two different ends of the covalent bond. Now, why is this? Well, if we think about a tug-of-war situation, there are two possible scenarios. Either both sides are equally strong, and so the rope, or in this case the pair of electrons, are shared evenly between the two teams or two sides, or one side is stronger than the other. And if one side is stronger than the other, they get more of the rope. Or in this case, the electrons spend a little more time around the stronger atom. Since electrons have a negative electrical charge, if they're spending more time around one atom than the other, that atom will have a partial negative charge, whereas the atom that has a bit less time with the electrons will have a partial positive charge. So there are two types of covalent bonds. And again, it goes back to that tug-of-war analogy. Either the electrons will be shared evenly, or they won't. Polar covalent bonds result when the electrons are not shared evenly between the two atoms involved in the covalent bond. And so this is that situation where the tug of war is not even, and the electrons spend more time around one atom than the other. Conversely, nonpolar covalent bonds evenly share the electron pairs between the two atoms. When a molecule is composed of polar covalent bonds, that means that the molecule has partial electrical charges on either side of that covalent bond. When dealing with electrical charges, opposites attract. With negatively charged particles being attracted to positively charged ones. While opposites attract, uncharged or neutral molecules, they will not mix with polar or charged molecules at all. So I'm going to introduce two terms now, hydrophobic and hydrophilic, and we'll see how this relates to the concept of both polar and nonpolar covalent bonds. Uncharged or neutral molecules are called nonpolar or hydrophobic. Hydro, in this case, referring to water, and phobic, meaning fearing. So the word hydrophobic literally translates into water fearing. Now, it's not that these molecules are actually afraid of water, but this behavior, the chemical properties that they have, they do not want to mix with water or other polar molecules. These nonpolar covalent bonds, or these neutral molecules, they do not have partial positive or partial negative charges, and so they don't want to mix with molecules that do have electrical charges. On the other hand, hydrophilic molecules, they are charged or polar, and they will mix with other charged molecules, including water. As we'll see in just a moment, water has polar covalent bonds. The word hydrophilic literally means water loving. These will be molecules that will happily mix and dissolve and integrate with water and other polar molecules. This can sometimes be confusing for students, and so a memory aid I like to think of are polar bears. Now, polar bears love water, and so polar molecules, they are going to be water-loving as well. Another thing that helps with this analogy is if you imagine yourself in a tug-of-war with a polar bear. That polar bear is much stronger than you are, and so it's going to win that tug-of-war. It will be a very uneven tug-of-war. So polar covalent bonds, it's when the tug-of-war is not even, and this results in molecules that are water-loving. So again, just think about polar bears. They love water, and they're much stronger than you are. Whether a molecule is polar, hydrophilic, or nonpolar, hydrophobic, is all based on its covalent bonds. Remember, hydrophobic and hydrophilic molecules will not mix. Although surprisingly, there are a few molecules. Which will be hydrophobic on one end and hydrophilic on the other. We'll talk about one of these, which is very important for the cell and how the cell functions, in just a moment. Yet another one, which you may be familiar with, is actually dishwashing soap or detergent. The way that dishwashing soap works is that it's hydrophobic on one end and hydrophilic on the other. The hydrophobic end is going to bind to the grease and the oil and the other things that would be hard to get off with just water alone. Yet the hydrophilic end of the soap molecule is going to be attracted to water. And in this way, that soap helps us remove grease and oil and other hydrophobic molecules from our dishes and from our utensils that otherwise would be very difficult to get off with just water alone. Now that we've talked about covalent bonds, in our next video, we'll discuss non-covalent bonds.